Father, thank you for your grace unto us, the grace that allows us to see each other, even if it's virtually, to share with each other, even if it's by technology, the reality that we know and are connected to one another through the power of your Holy Spirit. And even in, as we begin this time of turning our hearts more focused towards you, we see that we are able to receive messages from halfway around the world, thanks to technology. Technology that wouldn't exist unless you created the universe in precisely the way that you have created it. And so we're grateful to you for everything, but most particularly in this moment, we are grateful to you for how you allow us to come together in worship and encouragement, mutual encouragement, which is something that we're commanded to do in your word. We are commanded to encourage one another daily as long as it's called today. So thank you for the encouragement coming from Andrew and from seeing each one of our brothers and sisters here in worship. Thank you for the encouragement that will come as we share in music together and as we share in your word together. In Christ's name and to his glory, we pray. In Jesus' name. Amen.
This is interesting.
This
is how Christmas is celebrated in Africa. What about you, Kala? How do you celebrate Christmas? How are you celebrating Christmas in Canada?
In our family, Christmas has been a time to worship the newborn King, typically with friends and our church community. Gary and I would travel to be with the kids, and we're hoping that this year would provide us with more time with them. Instead, we will simply FaceTime with them and wander outside in the snow in our neighborhood, hoping to greet a few people in person, albeit at a distance.
Then would you please share your prayer request on a family level, but also on a ministry level?
My prayer request is that God may keep my family healthy as he did last year, especially my wife, my daughter, and her husband, who are working in hospitals, who are always exposed to diseases. But we were grateful that the whole year, nobody was affected. And even the situation in the country, although they speak about the rays of wave, it is not as it was the first time, and it is mainly in the capital city. So I pray also that the new year may come with a solution to the pandemic so that we may be able to meet our partners on the field again.
For prayer requests, my thoughts go to the churches in AEBR. The churches here have been closed since the middle of March because of COVID-19. Up until this point, there are still only 27 out of their 200 churches that are open. Most of them are still closed, and that has been so difficult for the congregations who have been needing encouragement and teaching and direction during this time of incredible crisis. It's been difficult for the pastors who have been with little or no income during all this time, and same with the denomination with no offerings coming in from the churches. So it's just been a difficult time, and we would request that you would pray for the churches in AEBR.
And on a personal note, since we've come back to Kigali, I've had a few health issues crop up. So I've had to have some tests, and actually I'm waiting for results on one now. We would appreciate it if you think of us to pray for me and for a positive outcome.
My prayer requests, I pray for my children so that they continue to improve in their studies, having also spiritual and good health. I'm praying also for my work in Congo, that our work plan for 2021, people will be attended for training, but also a change in their way of embracing the need of becoming peacemakers in the church, their family, and also outside the church, where the country can be also benefit from what they are learning.
I certainly appreciate your prayers for our family. Our son-in-law, Phil, works as an industrial electrician on a drill ship off the coast of Nigeria, and Stacy is a teacher. both face the risks of infection and exhaustion. Our four grandkids, like all children, have had a very disrupted year where many of the activities that are so typical to their development have been interrupted. My father lives with Gary and me, and his health has so far been very good. Gary and I are trying to figure out this life in new post full-time work era of our lives. So in the new year, I, along with my colleagues, will be focusing on how to best encourage marketplace ministries, also known as faith and work initiatives, alongside our Africa partners. Your prayers are appreciated for this as well. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
We do want to wish you Merry Christmas, and as I say here, Noheli Nziza.
Wow. This is who we are, what we do, our joy, and the struggles. Would you please join us in prayers? Again, we want to thank you for your continuous support in terms of finances, but also in prayers for CBM ministry in Africa. Once again, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year.
Hi, Pastor and everybody. So interesting that so many of their prayer concerns are exactly the ones that we have and that we were just talking about even. And I just wonder if we could pray together right now for a moment. And then I'll have these things written down to give to Christy for the next bulletin too, so we can remember these specific requests. So I just, if you could just join me right now in prayer, and I'm just going to pray for the African churches, God, and how we're bound together through this difficulty. And specifically, I ask for the strength of the church to remain, and somehow that you would provide for the pastors there in Africa who are without income. And God, I pray for the missionaries and their health. And at the same time, as we think of our own children and parents, for safety, I think specifically of their situations, protect the workers who are all suffering from exhaustion, and keep us all safe, and especially those in Africa where they're on the front line of a healthcare system that might be quite different than ours. We thank you, God, that we can share the journey together with these missionaries, and I pray that we would be able to get to know them even better. And I just think of all of our children and family that are struggling with anxiety and issues. I just pray that through all this difficulty, it would lead people to you, and our children especially, that they might open up their hearts and be able to understand that you give peace, that you have a plan, and that we can depend on you. And God, I just think of the people in Rwanda who have gone through just this most difficult of times with the two groups of people that have been so murderous to one another, and that they are able to use the church and your ways to teach the country. And God, I just pray for Rwanda, and I also just pray for peace in the world and in our country, and that we would find unity even through the difficulties, rather than have opposing groups who just make things so much more troublesome for us. God, we know that you are in charge. We seek you, we beg of you, and we thank you so much for being in our lives and in the lives of those people that we're supporting in Africa. In Jesus' name, amen.
I lift my eyes up to the mountains, where does my help come from? My help comes from you, maker of heaven, creator of the earth. I lift my eyes. I lift my eyes up to the mountains. Where does my help come from? My help comes from you, maker of heaven, creator of the earth. Oh, how I need you, Lord. You are my only hope. You're my only prayer. So I will wait for you to come and rescue me. Come and give me life. I lift my eyes up to the mountains. Where does my help from you, maker of heaven, creator of the
God is faithful forever.
setting sun. His love endures forever, and by the grace of God, we will carry on.
His love endures forever.
Sing praise.
You.
wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower or refuge or strength, let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship. To the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your. Cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord on the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. The mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound. Call your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Let's continue, friends, in prayer. Almighty and most gracious Heavenly Father, you are the great sovereign God. We've been singing your praises this morning. We've been considering the works of your hands. We've been bringing ourselves into that place where we are before you. And in doing this, we become so aware of how vast the difference is between you and us. And yet, you have reached into humanity's existence through the power of your spirit, through the power of your will, and through the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. And so you are not distant. you are close. And still, we must acknowledge that you are so much further above us, so much further beyond us, so much more righteous, so much more, so perfect, so true, so powerful, so just, so mighty. And we are grateful for that, for if you were none of those things, if you were even less in any way, of, in any measure of that, you would not be the God we need. For we are lowly and poor and in much need. And it would be not of any avail to us to reach out to you if you were not truly King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So we say you are truly King of Kings, Lord of Lords. You are truly God of Gods. You are truly the Most High. And yet you allow us to come before you, to kneel at your footstool, to place our requests before you, to share with you everything of our lives. And you make us welcome here. Forgive us, Father, for believing that we stand on our own. Forgive us, Father, for believing that we are somehow, in any way, any shape, at any time, independent of you. We are not. We are yours. We are yours. And so we seek your will. We desire your will to be done in our lives and in the world. And we see around us that so often your will is not being done. And we pray against that, and we pray for your will to come. And you know that we have all manner of requests. You know we have all manner of things that we would bring to you. We are so blessed that even in something like a tumble, a fall to the ground like Flo had, or like Mary had with Phoebe in her arms, that you intervene and little damage is done, and that we can recover from that and be well. You are so powerful, so capable, that you can provide for the least of our needs, but also the great ones. And so, Father, we implore you for work for Mark's family. We thank you that our own children, Susie's and mine, have been able to place their house on the market successfully, and that soon they may be moving into a place you will provide for them that is much more suited to the raising of their family. We are grateful, so grateful, that Gerhard is home after a very difficult weekend last weekend, where his health was hanging in the balance. And still you intervene and grant him grace, and grant grace to his wife and son. And we thank you. We are so thankful that little Isaac Nathan is among us now. And we pray forward for Stacy and her pregnancy, and Angela and hers, knowing that you will see these wonderful works through to their full fruition. We thank you that Gerd is home and recovering. We thank you that Brad B is home and doing all right. We pray for Tom H, who is homeless. We pray that you would change his heart towards what is offered to him, so that he would not have to be sustained in that he would come home to you, Lord. Father, we just received word that in-laws of ours may have lost two people today. We don't know anything more than that. Two cousins of our daughter's mother. And daughter-in-law's mother, and we don't know what that means. We haven't been able to hear anything more, but we give it to you right now, Lord. We give it to you, and we say they are in your hands, as our lives are in your hands, and we will not be distracted by that, for you have your eye on everything, when we can only have our eyes on what is before us. What is before us, Lord, is a world racked with antagonism, a world filled with uncertainty, a world stressed by all manner of cares. COVID-19, perhaps the chief of them, but even that is beginning to pale in the face of other things that we are seeing happening around the world. Oh, Father, that you would come down. Oh, Lord, that you would come down, that you would send your spirit down and you would bring things to right quickly. Yet we see that it is your design and desire that the kingdom grow. The kingdom that you've entrusted us with, the kingdom that we have become heralds of, ambassadors for, is a kingdom that grows one life at a time, one confession at a time, one conversion at a time. Help us ever be aligning our hearts and minds and spirits with you, Lord, and being able to welcome others into doing the same. Father, if we had any request in the immediate, it would be that you would free your churches in Canada, in all of North America, to celebrate the great sacrifice of your Son Christ, the Easter Passion, that we would be free to celebrate that in the presence of one another, physically. And yet we will celebrate whatever the circumstances. In 2021, we will celebrate the salvation of Christ more strongly than we ever have before. Father, be gracious and merciful unto your people, that we may be able to celebrate that in the joy of the presence of one another. Be with us now as we look into your word, Almighty God. Guide us, teach us, convict us, shape us. All to your glory. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. There we are, friends. Please turn in your Bibles, and I would really hope you have your Bibles for this one, to Romans chapter 3. We're going to read verses 9 to 20, and I'm going to speak on them. And again, this series in Romans is going to feel very much like a conversation, an ongoing conversation, because Paul weaves the important truths that God has revealed to him throughout his entire letter to the Roman church. And it's in that weaving that we can only look at significant portions of it at a time. And we need to get the sense, the flow, the understanding of each of these important foundational truths so that we can move on to the next one and receive the full blessing that God has for us in that. Romans 3, verses 9 to 20, is an extremely foundational truth for all of Christian life and faith. And I would ask you to think about this. Just one of these, if you can, multitask a little, open another window in your mind, that it is on the grounded truth of what we are about to read that John 3:16-17 becomes the incredibly powerful proclamation it is. Without what we are about to look at, without understanding the depth, power, intrinsic value of what we are about to look at, John 3:16-17 is weakened, and it does not become the powerful gospel proclamation it is, but it only is because of the truth that we are going to look at in God's words this morning. Paul is addressing what advantage Jews or Gentiles might have in the face of God's word. And now he brings everything home in a short passage that is mostly culled from excerpts of the Old Testament. This is foundational God truth that reaches across all of human history, all of created history. So let us read together. What shall we conclude then? Do we have any advantage? Not at all. We have already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under the power of sin. As it is written, there is no one righteous, not even one. There is no one who understands. There is no one who seeks God. All have turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. Their throats are open graves. Their tongues practice deceit. The poison of vipers is on their lips. Their mouths are full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways, and the way of peace they do not know. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law, so that every mouth may be silenced and the whole world held accountable to God. Therefore, no one will be declared righteous in God's sight by observing the law. Rather, through the law, we become conscious of our sin. Almighty Heavenly Father, this is your holy word. Today, it is a word that rests heavily upon us, but it is a necessary truth for us to receive. May we give you praise for this word, be it ever so heavy upon us, and may we be shaped, transformed, and liberated by your word. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, in Christ's name we pray. Amen. I called this sermon God Levels Humanity because in Paul's day and in our day, the issue of justice versus injustice, the issue of right versus wrong, the issue of the way to be against the way not to be was paramount. It's always been paramount. It has always been of the utmost importance, and it has marked human thought and conflict and community, human writing, endeavor, art, for all of recorded time. The truth is that there isn't, or does not appear to be, a leveling. There is injustice, inequality, imbalance everywhere. And one of the things that humans have tried to do, and were trying to do in the time of Paul and before Paul and even today, is to seek that balance, that leveling, that justice. And it's a laudable thing. I'm not going to speak against it. But there is the desire for a thing, and then there is the manner in which one goes about to try to obtain it or learn it or do it. Lately, more and more, I would say in Canada, the majority of people believe that the pathway to a more just and level society comes through these three ideas. And I'm not opposed to any of them individually, but when you take all of them together, they can bring us to going too far under our own power to seek to make right the wrongs of the world. I think that being a diverse people from all over the place is a wonderful thing. I'm a I was enjoying Edmonton so much when I was able to ride around on the bus and hear languages from all over the world and see people from all over the world. It was exciting. And for that matter, I'm a foodie, so having food from all over the world was a true blessing. But when diversity becomes regimented and enforced, it becomes a very heavy weight. And I believe inclusivity. I think we want to include people. We want to allow people to become part of those things that they desire to be a part of. Certainly the kingdom of heaven is open to all who will come. And for that matter, it would seem initially that the kingdom of heaven has no prerequisites, but it does. It has that prerequisite of submitting to the will of God. But it's an easy bar to go under once you fall in love with God. But when humans try to enforce inclusivity, suddenly they force people into relationships that are not in anyone's best interest and do not have outcomes in anyone's best interest. And finally, equality isn't something that we should turn our face away from. One academic who I love very much refers to the horror of inequality because as a social force, it can have catastrophic effects on people. But to have equity of outcome, regardless of recognizing what it takes to get there, to force equal outcomes into places where they don't fit, damages more than it helps. And all of this is becoming the way of the world because of one major point that is true, that is in the scriptures we have today. All of these things, despite the best of intentions that are put behind them, are failing for lack of one thing. God is not in them. There is no one righteous, not even one. No one who seeks God. All have turned away. In my lifetime, I've seen the title, I think, Is God Dead or God Is Dead, on the fronts of national magazines at least two or three times. It's returned almost as an annual rebuttal to Easter for a little while. But the reality is when human beings attempt to address the inequalities that they perceive in the world, the sin-filled world, they do so blinded to their own actions, which create those inequalities. And without a great measurement, without a great way to place everyone onto a playing field that levels us, there will always be these tremendous inequities, and whatever attempts we make in our own power will not work for us or for anyone else. See, there's an idea that I hear all the time. It says people are basically good. We hear this over and over again, and I have come to the point where I am realizing that every time a Christian hears this, every time a Christian sees that in a movie, every time a Christian sees that in a news article, hears it in a conversation, we really need to question where that's coming from, because according to the scriptures, and we have to decide what our authority is going to be, my friends. Is it going to be what people say, or is it going to be what God says? According to the scriptures, people are not basically good. I think every time I hear that now, my first response to the person is, do you really believe that? Because if people were basically good, wouldn't things look different? I know that people can be, in individual situations, remarkably good, remarkably caring, remarkably loving. I know that that's a fact. There's numerous stories. But on whole, on balance right throughout the world, if people actually were basically good, there'd be very little need for police, very little need for rules, very little need for laws, very little need for courts, very little need for door locks. But those are things that are all absolutely essential for our lives, regardless of where we live in the world. Because the scriptures say, people are not basically good. Because there's a basic problem. And until we as Christians truly embrace this idea and understand that people includes us, we can't get to a place that truly elevates the gospel for us and for others. We are here in this place, for the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. Paul understood this deeply. He understood that everyone is under the word of God. The word of God is primary. The word of God is over all. And the word of God, and the only word of God that is word of God, is the word of the Old Testament scriptures and the New Testament. Paul didn't know he was writing scripture, so he quoted what he knew was scripture. They've all turned away. They have together become worthless. There is no one who does good, not even one. And he includes himself in that group. They are swift to shed blood. Ruin and misery mark their ways. And here's the big one. There is no fear of God before their eyes. There is zero fear of God. Yet over and over and over and over again in the word of God, we find that the fear of the God is the beginning of things that keep us alive and wise and healthy and prosperous. There is, we think in terms of advantages. And we use these realities about ourselves, our ethnic background, as an advantage. It's become part of what they call the politics of intersectionality. If you're the right ethnicity, you have an advantage because you are somehow a victim worthy of having an advantage. God says, you have no advantage. Paul says, you have no advantage. There is no ethnic advantage. He talks about Jews, he talks about Gentiles. That covers the waterfront in his day. There is no ethnic advantage before God. Zero. You can't claim it. Even if you think you can claim it, you can't claim it. And so we go on and we say, well, there will be social advantages because of where you're born, or because of how you were born, or because of unto whom you were born, or the place that you're born, the society you're born in, the country you're born in, whatever the social milieu is that you are born into, whatever the social background, the web, the fabric, that's your advantage. Word of God says no. It's no social advantage. It doesn't matter who your parents were. It doesn't matter what nation you're a part of. It doesn't matter if you were born on the right side of the tracks or the wrong side of the tracks. It doesn't matter if you're born on the right side of the blanket or the wrong side of the blanket. It doesn't matter who your friends are. It doesn't matter what club you belong to. It doesn't matter what university you graduated from. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Your situation before God is the same as everyone else. And of course, there's no economic advantage, because absolutely every single thing that we can hold in our hands, everything that we can make, everything we can own, everything we can attain, everything we can gather, everything we can set aside, everything we can ascribe a value to isn't even ours to begin with. It all belongs to God. We literally live because he shares all that is his with us. This levels humanity in a wonderful, powerful, and surprisingly loving way that most people don't think about. Even I have been remiss in understanding that to be placed so completely, resolutely, irrevocably under the law of God, under his word, and under that word I find myself to be not righteous, but worthy of being judged and summarily convicted. I find that to be something that I don't want to think about enough, but when I do, oh friends, when I do, the possibility, no, the truth, the amazing grace of salvation becomes multiplied in power. We are all under the law. We are all under God's word. We are sinners, each and every one of us. We have sinned. We do continue to sin, although I pray that we sin less once we come into our sanctifying walk with Christ. But we cannot claim to be sinless. And it is here in Romans where Paul grounds what will become the most powerful proclamation of the gospel probably ever written down on this one immutable truth. All of humanity is equal before the word of God. All of humanity is level before the word of God. All of humanity is in the same place before the word of God. And despite whatever arguments we may have amongst one another as to who may be slightly up or slightly down, none of those things matter before a righteous God who has spoken his word over us. Sometimes I don't give you applications, and there's a reason. I cannot tell you how to personally make this truth a resolute cornerstone of your faith, other than this. You must contemplate this for some time. You must chew on this truth of Scripture, even if you find it difficult to chew. You must work it into your life, into your faith, into your understanding. What I will tell you is this: the deeper you allow this truth to sink into your life, the greater your joy will be in your realization of the grace granted to you by Christ. This is the ground of the gospel. This is the bedrock that makes everything that God did and is doing through Christ Jesus the most wonderful, powerful truth in all of human history. Let us pray. Almighty and most gracious Heavenly Father, forgive us for believing that at some point we're okay, that we somehow have slipped out from underneath the blanket of your word and the truth that it tells us about ourselves. Forgive us for having believed that at some point we have managed to, by some means of our own, by some action that we have taken, by some thought we have thought or word we have spoken, that we have managed to sidestep the reality of who we truly are. Forgive us, forgive us, forgive us. Keep us close to the truth of our broken and needy estate so that we can revel more deeply, more fully, more completely in the joy of your redemptive love and care in spite of who we are. Let us live our lives every moment, Father, as though we have just been released that moment from the fowler's snare, that we have just been snatched that moment from the maw of the gaping maw of the lion about to consume us, that we have just been cut free from the chains that enshackled us and were to hold us for all eternity. Let us live every moment of our lives, understanding how close we have been to complete this solution and how powerful it is for us to be declared free by your grace. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen.
Sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven to earth to show.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you. Make his presence in your life so powerful and real that you cannot escape it. May he lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his everlasting shalom. And now, go in the peace of the Lord.